Pacífico y Océano Índico figura entre las zonas de mayor dinamismo mundial por ser conducto y centros de crecimiento económico a la vez, a pesar de dificultades y disputas o enfrentamientos. It has generated geopolitical and geostrategical changes, each with opportunities and challenges. In that sense, what economic financial architecture does the ASEAN configure? Is it inclusive? To what interest does it answer with China and India heading the organization? What dynamics will it guarantee peace and stability for the people in Southeast Asia, Indo-Pacific, and surrounding regions?
Para los pueblos del sudeste asiático y en el Indo-Pacífico y regiones circundantes, evidentemente.
How could Latin America integrate with policy in tune to this world neurologic center? Asia-Pacific perspectives, Asian and allies. This is what we're going to be seeing today. We're going to see information. We'll have guests. And as always, thank you for your company.
Decía Noticias. Allí vamos a nuestra primera.
Here we see our first. 10 members of the Association of the Nations of Southeast Asia, ASEAN. They met on the 22nd and 23rd June in Thailand's capital, Bangkok, at the 34th summit of the organization, a two-day meeting that joined high-level leaders. The economic aspect occupied one of the first places in the agenda, especially for the Regional Comprehensive Economic Association, RCEP, which is an ambitious free trade agreement between ASEAN, Australia, China, India, Japan, South Korea, and New Zealand. That is 16 nations, and that would create the largest economic bloc in the world by gathering almost 40% of the GDP and population of 3.4 billion people. Thailand, which also holds the rotating presidency, this year welcomed the summit of the regional organism. Let's hear its representative, the Prime Minister Prayut Chan-o-cha. Given that there is a greater uncertainty in the global economy and a greater competition that has an effect on the world's finances economies, this includes the commercial conflict that could undermine the commercial atmosphere in the world and could lead to a total commercial war. We have to relieve these tensions and create a greater balance. Thailand, as president, is trying to accelerate the conclusion of the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership negotiations within this year. That is an intention that all leaders have affirmed. Let's see Southeast Asia. Let's go to the map. It is one of the 32 subregions in which United Nations divided the world. In this subdivision are Brunei, Cambodia, the Philippines, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, East Timor, and Vietnam. Let's see if we can see it. Let's see the map. There it is. It's from Indonesia, a little to the right, and Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines,
Cambodia,
Thailand, Laos, and Myanmar. And it covers a surface of 5 million square kilometers. It limits to the north with Eastern Asia, to the south with Indian Ocean, which separates it from Australia, east with the Pacific Ocean, the south of the southern China, Micronesia, and Melanesia, which, while to the west, it borders with the Indian Ocean and to the Gulf of Bengal. Northwest is the South Asia. It contains two divisions, Indochina, continental part, and the archipelago Malayo, which is called Insulandia. In the part of, if we see this concept, in this part of the world, there is an Asian regional agency, and it's near the ocean, and it depends on context, and includes part of Asia.
De Asia Pacífico es mucho más abarcador aún que el sudeste asiático. Y en todo ello juega un papel fundamental el Marvel,
all of this,
en el cual hay ciertas disputas abiertas en este momento y luego iremos en esa dirección. En esta parte
in this part of the world, there is an Asian as a regional agency. Let's remember what it's about, foundation, members, objectives, and geopolitical relevance.
A unos 650 millones de personas y tiene más de 50 años de existencia.
The Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN, it is an international organization with regional scope. It was founded in August 1967 with the signing of the Declaration of Bangkok between Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines, Malaysia, Singapore, Brunei, was admitted in 1984, Vietnam in 1995, Laos and Myanmar in 1997, and finally Cambodia in 1999. Russia became a full partner in the Asian Cooperation Dialogue. In 2003, the Asian community concept was fully approved. In the structure, there's an organization of permanent secretary that works in the headquarters located in Jakarta, Indonesia. The secretary rotates every 5 years. In addition, a permanent committee of representatives with a delegate by each member of 11 specialized committees. The headquarters of the summit changes annually according to the alphabetic order in English. The main objective of the ASEAN is to accelerate economic growth and foster regional peace and stability. It gathers emerging economies that represent 11% of the gross domestic product in Asia Pacific. It exports and imports represents 24 and 23 of the GDP respectively. ASEAN is today the seventh largest economy in the world of GDP of $2.5 million and expects to be the fourth most important economic bloc in the world for the 2030. With Japan, it maintains a joint forum with the European Union and the Eurostatic Economic Union. It maintains official commercial cooperation agreement. From a geopolitical point of view, the countries that integrate ASEAN represent, according to the theory of journalist and university professor, considered also one of the fathers of this theory, Nicholas Spykman, the southeastern part of the rimland or the land from the edge of the Eurasian supercontinent is a conflict area of interest of the continentalist and Atlantic countries. Spykman says that whoever controls the rimland controls all Eurasia. Let's see if we can go further into this.
De la relevancia geopolítica con nuestro
let's go to
a ver, fíjense, me voy a prensa latina.
Latin Press of juntos. June 23rd of 2019. ASEAN consolidates the Southeast Asia as a regional as a region of peace and progress. This is from Bangkok, and it says that during the ceremony of opening of the summit, the Prime Minister of Thailand, Prayut Chan-o-cha, said that the strong and united ASEAN is the main guarantee of peace, stability, and development in the region. On the bottom, it says the leaders of the bloc inaugurated the so-called ASEAN satellite warehouse in Thailand province of Chainat, a modern style that will help the regional community face natural disasters through rapid rescue and gender-based logistic support zones affected by natural disasters. It also says digital economic. They also created a cybersecurity center to strengthen borders and money laundering. And for its name, it's RCEP. Let's go to Deutsche Welle of June 22nd, 2019. It says Southeastern Asian leaders approve agreements against trash on the sea. And below the picture it says, baptized as the Bangkok Declaration, it reaffirms the commitment of the bloc to promote cooperation in the protection, restoration, and sustainability use of the coastal and maritime environment with the objective of facing the contamination that puts ecosystems at risk. It is a declaration to combat pollution in the seas that seeks by 2025 prevent and significantly reduce all kinds of trash in the oceans. This is because four of the members Indonesia, Philippines, Vietnam, and Thailand are considered, next to China, as the responsible of half of the plastic contamination in the oceans.
Bueno, así lo dice acá en esta nota del medio alemán. Y me voy ahora al portal.
Let's go to the Diplomat webpage. Has an evaluation of the new perspective of the Asian Indo-Pacific.
A ver, centro acá.
Let's go click in.
Para que puedan acompañarme. Dice, ardientes
it says the defenders of the ASEAN argue that the ASEAN has promoted the Indo-Pacification of the Asian regionalism over time to include a greater participation of the main powers through the mechanisms of the Eastern Asia Summit. During the 2019 summit, the organism presented its perspective on the Indo-Pacific in a short documentary with the acronym AOIP, which represents the first official version publicly disclosed on the version of the vision of the ASEAN in the region. Here we have it as translated.
De la AOIP. También vamos a intentar
let's see what AOIP is further on. The Center of International Relationships of the Faculty of the Government of the Development University in Chile, January 3, 2018, said Asia Pacific, the new neurological center of global geopolitics by Veronica Nerme Echeverria, lawyer, master in political science, and advisor to the Asia Pacific topics. And it says, Asia is not free of problems and regional conflicts that due to the importance of the region has acquired. Should they grow, they would have repercussion all around the world. To counteract the protectionist USA stance, China has emerged as the defender of free trade. The territorial disputes between China and the countries of other powerful focus on the conflicts in the middle term, where China vindicates its sovereignty not only for the riches of the soil and underground of the islands they are located, but also because it constitutes a strategic control point for regional and global commerce. Okay, this is what the author believes. So having seen all of these elements, let's analyze all of this information.
En la geopolítica y economías mundiales. Y también tenemos que ver esto en términos económicos.
And we have to also analyze this under the economic perspective.
En medio de disputas comerciales
because there are
este mismo momento.
Some problems there. When we return, what is the importance of Asia Pacific in global geopolitics and economy?
We're back in our critical moves.
Asia-Pacific, global politicals and economy, challenges of the ASEAN in the middle of the commerce disputes.
Y amenazan el sistema de comercio multilateral. Esto entre comillas, porque es lo que se lee textual en uno de los documentos derivados de esta
última cumbre that came out from the summit. It is also added that the organization, World Trade Organization, faces challenges in the midst of disputes. So there is going to be a need for inclusive and comprehensive organization of trade. The summit has joined authorities on how to
participantes abogan por el multilateralismo.
All of the authorities question the protectionist policy of the U.S. and propose the creation of a comprehensive trade organization with Asia and six other countries of the region. It appeared in 2012 as an initiative of China. At a first moment, it tried to be a counterpart for the trade agreement signed by the U.S. However, with the protectionist policy of the U.S., the RECEP can be a way for China to expand their commerce among the countries that are in the pact are Australia, Japan, and South Korea, and India and New Zealand. In the case of China, it's been increasing every time their bilateral commerce with the Asian zone. And it grew 14% to the previous year.
Tiempo de sumar la visión de nuestros analistas.
Let's
primero vamos a
see what our analysts
Buenos Aires,
say.
Argentina. Allí nos espera Ernesto
From
Matos,
Buenos Aires, Argentina, we have Ernesto Matos.
Y bueno, muy oportuno este perfil.
He's economist and international
que queremos
analyst.
Desarrollar el punto económico, ¿no? Y su repercusión en lo geopolítico al mismo
we
tiempo. Ernesto, bienvenido a la jugada. Gracias por atendernos.
Ernesto, thank you for being with us.
De concretarse esta asociación entre 16 países.
Should this association between 16 countries happen, what would we have?
Bueno, la idea de la ASEAN,
well,
lo que está buscando
the idea of the ASEAN is to have China is to diminish the position of the U.S.
That
after the meeting, they made another block
that
has
social
partners. They also have the United Kingdom. This is a move of the between these main powers to increase trade and carry out their economic policy. We're watching
a
free trade time and
it's
back in time already. There's an implosion. Now the world in its financial institutions
tienen una política de libre comercio.
Have a policy of free trade. And this is what some countries
están adoptando. Lo que
are adopting.
Son las consecuencias a futuro que podría traer.
Of course, there might be consequences in the future.
Algunos países que administran
su comercio, why some countries who
si
administer the commerce,
está bien, pero si es otro
if it's
país,
with the U.S., fine.
Unidos, si
but if it's another country,
está mal.
They don't agree with it. So here's what all the discussion is. And China wants this regional agreement,
ASEAN,
be what allows to subtract power from the U.S. influence. In this context of commercial war and the actors who participate in this negotiation, we have there are some allies of China, and how can such divergent interests meet in the same space? Is this possible?
La mayoría de los países del ASEAN, del Asia Pacífico,
the,
están
most
en
of the Asian
regional.
Countries are in the regional agreement, except for Thailand,
que sería como una economía emblemática, pero no está así Singapur.
But
entonces,
Singapore
no
isn't there. So there are,
and
some are with the U.S., some are not.
El Asia Pacífico que comanda Estados Unidos,
so the Asia Pacific that is commanded by the U.S. is just 13%.
En este caso, China,
however,
the
one that is led by China and the countries of the ASEAN represent 40% of the GDP if we add Australia, New Zealand, Japan, India. So that's where the dispute really is and the need to carry out agreements. That's why the United States is taking so long.
Sea junto con la India,
and
que obviamente ya está alcanzando los niveles de población que está teniendo
they
China.
Can see that India and China are growing rapidly.
es un centro económico.
Now let's go with Ernesto again. Is this a neurologic center in terms of economic development? Is it strategic? ASEAN is today the seventh global economy of the GDP, with a GDP of 2.5 million, and expects to be the fourth by the year 2030. Of course, it's an economic space with which many countries want to negotiate. But they also have a very important theoretical structure.
Antes de la crisis del 29, porque un pensamiento de libre comercio,
so
darwinismo económico,
it is free trade.
Era justamente lo que llevó a la crisis del capitalismo. Entonces, esto vuelve bajo
so this comes back as a new form in a new economic space organization, and it has to do a lot with the formation of these countries, with their cultural. So the Asia Pacific is produced far more cheaper than in other parts of the world. They try not to affect the others. Of course, this conditions the development of the local companies, and this creates a lot of disputes. So many other regions will have to see if they're competitive when they're going to do so against the Asian Pacific region. What would be the opposite of this? The opposite would be organizations with each one of the countries could administer their commerce according to their national growth they want to adopt. Today there's a pressure on the FMI and the World Trade Organization that has influence on the U.S. and the European Union. So it's not casual where the agreement of Asian Pacific, in which the United States is still a member. So there's these two countries are the ones that have major deregulation. And this is what led to the 2008 crisis. Many countries have not recuperated yet. And for example, the Monetary Reserve will try to keep a low interest rate to help and buy as many companies as possible. So they're trying to buy actions or the companies themselves. So of course they have influence in every economic space. Okay, we're not talking about anybody. What is the geopolitical relevance? Can you identify as an international analyst of this part of the world? Well, mainly that zone is if they can add to India. Of course, India is already he is one of the main actors in the Davos meeting, where they said what is their world vision. And of course, they're the following leader after China. And they'll try to clear off any differences with China in order to work with them. And there's this regional economic agreement. Oh yeah, so there many countries will think on what's going to be the way they act, because they can compete with the rest. So this is why we need to stop
Ernesto,
the growth of this.
Por este tiempo que nos
Thank you, Ernesto, for your time.
No, no hay por qué. Un saludo a todos.
Saludos de vuelta. Allí teníamos a Ernesto Matos, economista, analista internacional desde Capital Argentina, y hacia allá vamos.
And let's go back to Argentina.
Now
via telephone. It's Nicolás Salerno. He's a researcher in the National University of Lanús.
En este momento,
and he's with us right now.
Gracias por estar con la jugada crítica de Telesur, y le pregunto por
We
la
ask you.
Geopolítica.
What is the geopolitical relevance? Do you think this is an important turning point in Asia? Good afternoon. Of course, it's a very strategic place for South Asia. What I'm sincerely worried of is the zone of free trade, the elimination of every tax, because of course we have everything to offer to the world with great quality. Of course, there are other countries that can offer it, but not as good quality as we have. It's worrisome because it seems like China, with these new measures, are going to look for their markets, and the U.S. could have a stronger influence in the region. Where the U.S., what they did is they went on with the bilateral agreements. In that sense, what I'm most worried about is the South American countries that, far from having integration, they're going back and destroying their political parties.
Es lo que está planteando la Asociación Económica Integral Regional
que
en este momento
negociaciones
y que dicen sus líderes
regional organization and they hope to finish by this year. Is this what you're talking about? Exactly. This is what I'm talking about. And the most developed country are China, Japan, India, Singapore. And with the others, I really don't know what could happen and what would be the effect for Latin America, because there's this commercial war. And what would be the influence and consequence? Maybe there could even be less commerce for Latin America. And we would have more dependency on the U.S. and Europe. So in that case, we would have to see how our Latin America be integrated to a more convenient policy. Yes, of course. In any case, China is not thinking of great ports of communication in any part of America. So maybe it's maybe they'll have a stronger ties or less stronger ties. Until now, you would think that the integration with the U.S. and China could not alter the plans of Latin America. Let's see if we can go deeper
la competencia estratégica entre Estados Unidos y China y los efectos que tiene
in this
sobre los otros países,
conflict between
Estados
China and the U.S. and the consequences on other smaller countries. So, the Latin American region exports the can only 1%. So, this means that the major concentration is in this area.
de todo el comercio de
and
China,
that all of the commerce
América Latina representa solo el 6%
of China, it's only the US, the Latin America is only 6% of it.
No es el comercio sustancial que tiene y es el potencial enorme que podría tener.
It's the great potential it could have.
Tensión geopolítica que está existiendo entre los bloques regionales.
So this gives you what the balance is between the commercial blocks in the region and the governments.
Toda la integración con lo que es la comunidad andina debería ser una mayor integración.
And that there be a major integration to make it stronger.
A ver, cuando miramos
when we see in the map everything that you have in that region, there is no need to be a witch to see that they're playing against the sea, the cards. You have to understand that there are disputes at the moment. We would like to join us after a small pause.
Si puede, señor Nicolás Salerno. Y ya venimos para seguir
de we'll right back.
Si le parece. Asia-Pacífico, perspectiva
perspective and challenges.
El mar de la China meridional, que ha sido y es espacio en disputa.
China Sea is a place of dispute with the countries that surround it, litigate for their control, because there are very important maritime routes and great resources in the area.
Por las aguas del disputado mar de la China meridional pasa la segunda ruta comercial más
importante
del mundo.
There's a second route of maritime commercial in this area.
Además, estima que con
additionally, it has 7 billion barrels in reserve and natural gas. Four members of CN want the control of it: Brunei, Asia, Vietnam, and China with Taiwan, who also wants to be independent from China and has interests in the sea, where it is part of their province. But we also have to take into account the U.S., the powers of the U.S. The conflicts are based in two types of islands, that the Paracels Islands and the Spratly Islands. China says that these islands were part of their territory. Vietnam says that they have documents to prove that they are the owners. Brunei and Malaysia say that they are within their economic exclusive areas. And all of the other countries also allege that they're owners of them.
La redacción de esa hoja de ruta, más probabilidades habrá de un incidente marítimo con grandes repercusiones.
Prosigamos el análisis.
Let's continue with our analysis. Next with to Nicolás Salerno of the University of Salerno. He's talking to us via telephone from Buenos Aires. Let's see this. We have some points of the China Sea, which is fundamental to understand the interests that surround them. Of course, especially with the topic of Taiwan and the conflict they have with China. We have to see that there are resources, fishery and natural resources there. To control the maritime route of the zone is very important because it allows the flow of raw materials and resource of energetic resources. Yes, in fact, and all of the tax topics that have to do with all of this commerce. And it's a great part of the commercial operations in the world. So we don't know how this dispute would be resolved
no está claro que
it's not clear how China has thought about coming up with a solution with this. Do you know what's going on with the military movements there in the zone? What's the tendency?
Well,
militarization is far apart from the commerce aspect. What I can say is that any political conflict has to do with economy. And if China tries to advance with the economic pressures, but they will have huge consequences because of the countries in the zone. So there could be a negative point in this expansion of commerce and trade. And of course, China speaks of zones of free trade, but their military movements doesn't say the same. So what does the U.S. have to do there? Well, no, the U.S. has no reason of being there. No power can justify any other power. But if we analyze the conflicts that we've seen in the region, not always all the people involved have to do with it. For example, the U.S. has nothing to do with there, but they're still in the midst of the conflict. And everybody just tries to defend their interests. When we speak about ASEAN, if we explain this in detail, we can see that there are divergent interests. We were asking Ernesto this, and he says, on one hand, there are the strategic allies of China, and on the other hand, there are the strategic partners of the U.S. In that sense, can they converge in the same space? Is this possible? Well, any change of time and transition, political hegemony, so the fall of ancient powers were the ones that let loose the First World War. The truth that today we're seeing how Trump is coming to an end as the governor of this. Well, we don't know what's the end going to be. At least this is the big doubt. We don't know where the fight is going to go to, and there might escalate to an international conflict. Or will China be able to take the lead of this transition? And we cannot speculate on any future plans. We also have to take into account Russia's position, which is not small at the moment. And Russia is willing to come into the conflict. Yes, and with the tensions with the European Union, all of the problem with Crimea, with the tension of the European Union, is important if several points of high confrontation in the world, this new configuration, but we cannot foresee how this is going to end. But we have to be very cautious because the stakes are very high. Thank you very much, Nicolás. Thank you very much. Let me show you this article. We have in our last play of the game, it says, this sea is very relevant for many countries of Asia Pacific because there's a commerce that spreads through the area. that have generated a situation of dispute. And there, the regional countries are not exempt of participating. Even the name is a conflict in the region. Each country has a different name for the sea. But the name that they use is an effort to appropriate themselves of this area. They're going to call it the China Sea. And because the author believes that China is the most powerful country in the area.
Explotar un fondo marino rico en crudo, gas natural y materias primas. Allí la importancia de las.
There we see the importance of the strategy that are going on.
En el mar de la China Meridional, que data del 11 de diciembre de 2018 y es de la autoría de Arsenio Cuenca. Miramos su.
This is from Arsenio Cuenca. Let's see the last part of this investigation. As we said, it's a fundamental part of land in Southeast Asia. This is Arsenio Cuenca. He's from Córdoba, graduated in psychology in Sevilla. And all of the countries there have an interest. And not only the ones in the region, but the ones abroad, like the U.S. This is a very challenging. Both our guests coincided, say that it's very worrisome, the ASEAN agreement that wants to sign with China and with other countries. So, let's keep on analyzing. Thank you for being with us.